Okay, so first, I would like to thank Thierry Mara and all the organizers of this beautiful conference in this beautiful place, in this beautiful island, and in this beautiful country. Thank you, Thierry. So, excuse me. I talk about the sensitivity analysis of stochastic computer codes. So I will first define what I call a stochastic computer code. Just I have to say that I have made this work with Thierry Klein and Agnès Lanioux from Institut Mathématique de Toulouse, and with my colleague from EDF, Loïc Legracier and Mathieu Couplet. This work has been done in 2014 in the framework of the project Asynchrone, project financed by nuclear industry, French nuclear industry. Usually, in sensitivity and uncertainty analysis, we deal with what we call computer codes, and most often, deterministic. Deterministic means that for the same inputs of the function g, g is my code, we have always the same output. This is the particularity of the when we make computer experiments, is that we have no error. Okay, so in this talk, I have p inputs, which are scalar, and I consider one output, which is also scalar. The main objective of uncertainty and sensitivity analysis and the framework of my talk is that I want to make some uncertainty propagation. I would like to make some reliability analysis of the output, sensitivity analysis. I can be interested by global optimization problem, by calibration problem, etc., etc. And most often, when we have to deal with CPU time-consuming models, we have to find some good algorithm. And in this talk, I will focus on the algorithm based on metamodels. So a stochastic computer code is a code where when we launch, when we run the code with the same set of inputs, we can have different outputs. It's because we have some intrinsic noise inside the functions that we evaluate. So here, I just formalize this like this. You have an additional noise called epsilon. So what is epsilon? Epsilon can be, for example, a random seed which is integrated inside the model. And so when we launch, when we run with the same input x, we have not the same output. In the computer experience literature, we can find this kind of problems when we deal with some event models. Jack Linen has shown many examples in this framework. In my company, for example, we can have a stochastic model when we deal with asset management model, and we model some lifetime of a component by putting some random events on this lifetime. In my talk, I will focus on Monte Carlo based models, so I explain this after. And we have also these situations when inside the model, we deal with a stochastic process. So in fact, epsilon induced some stochastic process realizations. I have talked about this subject in 2007 in the SAMO, so 10 years ago, yes, I was young, in 2007 in Budapest. Okay, so for stochastic model, we have the same problem. If the code is consuming, it's time consuming, we have to deal with algorithmic solutions, for example, metamodels. As a motivating example, I put here what is interested in the Asynchrone project. This is a nuclear reactor physics. We have some codes to compute the the neutron irradiation of some object inside the nuclear core. So just a few pictures. Here you have a nuclear vessel. Here you have the what we can find inside this vessel. And what is interesting is the fuel assembly. And this is the modeling of all this system. And what we want to do is to compute some quantities coming from the nuclear reaction inside the core. So to model this, we can use some Monte Carlo codes. Each red point is a neutron, and we have to count how many neutrons arrives at a particular locations. So in fact, in this kind of stochastic code, we are just interested by the mean of a score function, okay? And this is what I will focus on this thing here. So this is just a motivated example, but it's difficult to explain, so I stop here. Sobel sensitivity analysis. So I am interested by formalizing. I don't know if it's very English, formalizing, but I use it. Formalizing, you understand? Okay, thank you. Formalizing the Sobel indices in the case of this kind of model. So in fact, my underlying model is G, okay, but I don't have access to G. I don't run G, I run F. Okay, and G is the expectation of F. I recall here just the definition of the first order Sobel indices. So this has been explained before. So I don't need to re-explain it. I will focus here on the first order Sobel indices. And I will use this estimator of these indices. This estimator I've been developed by Hervé Monod in 2006 and more recently by Alexandre Janon. So this is, as the other estimators of Sobel indices, it uses two independent samples, for example Monte Carlo independent samples, and by rearrangement of the column we estimate the Sobel index. I don't explain this here, but this is the classical algorithm of the Sobel index. And what is particular in this estimator is just the arrangement inside the formula. What is interesting with this estimator is that we have some theoretical properties obtained by Janon et al. We know that asymptotically, this estimator is normal and also efficient. So it means that asymptotically, this is the best estimator we can have. Asymptotically, of course. And it requires, to estimate the first order Sobel indices, it requires this number of calls to G, where P is the number of inputs and N is the size of the independent matrix. I have said that I have not access to G, so I have to estimate G in my real problems. So I define what I called a simulator. This is just the empirical mean. I make some independent realizations of F, and after I take the empirical mean to obtain an approximation of G. Okay, so small n is the number of runs I use with F. So I have an error here. Okay, so I have access to G, but this is with an error. Okay, so I can call this a noisy simulator, in fact. This is a noisy simulator. So the question is, can we use the estimates of the Sobel indices with this to estimate the Sobel index of G? So we think that, of course, it's possible. But with my colleague, we have shown that there is no theoretically, it's exact. We use this result from this paper. I give the reference in the end of the talk. If the variance of the error is of the order 1 over n, then we have the asymptotic normality of the estimator of the simulator for estimating the true Sobol index. We don't have asymptotic efficiency with this. If we want asymptotic efficiency, we need a more stronger assumption. In our case, this is a Monte Carlo estimator, so it's very simple to prove that the variance of the error is this, 1 over n, of this multiplied by this mean, and this mean is constant, in fact. And so this is of the order of 1 over n. So we have verified this assumption, and we can use, conclusion, we can use the estimate of the Sobol index of this simulator to estimate the Sobol index of the true functions that we are interested in. Right? Thank you. It's not finished. Numerical test on a toy functions. This is a toy function that I choose. I introduce inside the formula some noise with these three random variables, but I am interested, of course, by the Sobol indexes with respect to x1 and x2. In this case, we can obtain the true functions. Enfin, it's not the true function, it's the functions I want to focus on. This is, we integrate with respect to the epsilon, and we obtain these true functions, and I represent this function here by the level set. Yeah. Okay, so I just start with a small experiment. I have two n, the small n for the computing the empirical mean, and the large n for the algorithm of the Sobol indices, okay, the size of the matrix. I first choose big N equals to small n. And here I have just computed the first order Sobol indices in functions of this size. I can see that when I reach 10,000, I have precise estimations. I didn't repeat the experiment. I have to do it, but I didn't have the time to see the error. This is not very rigorous. Nice picture, isn't it? So I found this kind of visualization. It's not terrible, but I found it in R. It represents here the estimation errors I have between the estimator and the truth. And the width of the bubble is proportional to the value of the error. So for this kind of width, I have 1% of error. Here I have 0.2%, and this large bubble is 15%. Well, I know it's not a very good picture, and I will never publish it. But okay, I have made it. Here, so I distinguish on the axis the size of the matrix in the algorithm of estimation of the index, and here the number of replicates to estimate each time the empirical mean. Okay, so basically, I can say that I am happy in this zone and this zone. So it's just to give an idea of the convergence. It's not very rigorous, but I have an idea of the convergence. So when we increase the size in both dimensions, we decrease the error, hopefully. Okay, so, but as you see, I have used many runs of F to obtain here, because the cost is the number of replicates. I have 5 minutes, I think. Yes. 10 minutes, okay. The cost is the number of replicates times the cost here, times 3 the size of the matrix. It 3 is just come from this, to compute a Sobol index, we need n times p plus 1. So here p is 2, so I have made 3n. So from this formula, if I see I am happy with 10,000 here and 1,000 here. So 1,000 times 10,000, ça fait beaucoup. It makes a lot. What I propose is to use metamodeling, because the direct method for these estimations is unreachable in my practical case. So I propose to replace the simulator by a metamodel, which is a Gaussian process. But as we are in the stochastic case, this Gaussian process is non-interpolating and heterosedastic. It means that the variance is not the same at the different x. I have just put the formula of the predictor of the Gaussian process and the mean square error associated to this predictor. What we can do, what we can say is that I introduce here this variance due to the stochastic computer code, okay? And this is a diagonal matrix, and in each term of this diagonal matrix, we have the variance, and we call this the nugget in Krieging. This is the variance, so the error associated to the x. Just a figure, so if this is the true functions in dotted lines, at each x, we make some replicates to estimate the variance of the error, and so this is indicated in red. Okay. Alors, my colleague, it's not me, it's my colleague who has proposed, Loïc Legrassier, who has proposed an algorithm to build this Gaussian process non-interpolating metamodel. So first, we choose m points in the input space with a space filling design, okay? But at each point, we have to make some replicates. So he proposed first to make 500 replicates at each point. Second, we have a given budget of a number of runs we can make with the computer codes. And he has proposed to use the integrated mean square error criterion. This is a criterion to judge the quality of the metamodel. And we use a criterion to find the number of replicates, the optimal number of replicates we have to put on each point in order to have the best metamodel we can obtain. So this is particularly complex, and I will not give the details here. And after, we can make a sequential enrichment of the design by using the same criterion. At each time, we can measure the expected IMSE decrease, and we choose the point in the design space and the number of replicates we put on each the design the point to maximize the decrease, in fact. Well, I don't know if it's clear, but just I illustrate this with this figure. the same toy function than before. Okay. This is the functions, the true functions, the mean of f, and this is the variance of f, but I don't know these two functions. So the initial design, we have chosen 12 points regularly spaced in the b-dimensional input space, and the algorithm tells us the number of replicates we have to make on each point of this design to have the best IMSE criterion. And after, we apply 5 or 10 times the sequential algorithm to enrich the design. Finally, when we have obtained this Gaussian process metamodel, we use it. We replace the computer code by the metamodel to estimate the Sobol indices. We take this paper, always the same colleague, Le Gracier, this paper who has proposed an algorithm to compute the Sobol indices using a Gaussian process, but by controlling also the error due to the metamodel approximation. This is the advantage of the Gaussian process, is that we have a predictor for the metamodel, but as we also have the error, we can propagate the error on what we estimate, and so we obtain a mean Sobol index and a confidence interval for the Sobol index. Bon. This has been explained in 2013, I think, in the SAMO conference. This is the result here with the toy functions. In APSIS, we have the total budget, the number of runs we made on F. This is the metamodel predictivity, what we called the Q2, and this is the percentage of variance explained by the metamodel. So I can say that I am happy here, which correspond at 0.98. It means that I explain 98% of the variance of my output, and it corresponds to a budget of 45,000 runs of F. And this is here just the convergence of the first order Sobol indexes for the first variable and here for the second variable. So of course it converges to the true value. And in finally, we can conclude that with respect to the direct model, when we don't use the metamodel, using this metamodel allows to divide by a factor of 10 or 100 for the total budget which is required to estimate these Sobol indices. Okay, but I have finished, in fact. Just my conclusion. Thank you, Andrea. It's not a conclusion. The 2 point is just the perspective. It's costly. It's a procedure rather costly because, as you see in this figure, we made several thousand of replicates on each point of the design. So it can be costly. But so if we want to avoid the replicates, perhaps we can use what we have done before by the joint metamodeling. And the joint metamodeling consists of building a metamodel for the mean and a metamodel for the variance jointly. And it doesn't require to make some replicates on the design point. But we don't have tests this for the moment on these toy functions. And more recent work of my beautiful PhD students here. Oh. The metamodeling of the probability density. It can be interesting, not in this case, but in some applications, it can be interesting to have a metamodel which can build all the probability density functions of the stochastic output. So we have worked on this subject, on the meta modeling of the PDF, the CDF, or the quantile function of this of the output conditionally to X. Okay. Yes. This is so. As I have 1 minute, I have 1 minute. This is just for this kind of applications that I talked before, the asset management applications. So thank you. If you want the reference of my the main reference of this talk, are this. Thank you, Andrea.
Thank you, Bertrand. I think we have two or three minutes for questions immediately. Anyone wants to? Yeah, Sergei?
I have one. To press something? Okay. When you said replications, does it mean that it's in a bootstrap sense that you didn't estimate your function anymore, you just bootstrap, or you really meant that you now, for each replication, you have a new design and you do new computer estimation? This replication, can you explain what did you mean by replication here?
Thank you. No, there's no bootstrap here. Replications is just on my toy function, a replication. In fact, my noise in this toy function, my noise is induced by these three random variables, epsilon 1, epsilon 2, and epsilon 3. So it's just another random realization of these true variables. In my real application, for example, this one, there is inside the code there is a random seed which govern the I'm not a specialist of neutronics but I think there is a random seed which govern the launching of the neutron, but in fact I don't know the details of this but it's important. But what can I say in my other examples? These examples, in fact, inside the model, we have a failure model. So we simulate some failure of some component. So we have a lifetime model, and with this lifetime model, we simulate some failure. So this is governed by a random seed, and this is just this is a Monte Carlo realizations, not bootstrap. I don't know if it's clear. But I work on this kind of subject for 10 years, and I think I begin to understand, but I'm not sure.
That you used n for sample size and n small for replications, right?
Yes.
So n is basically also replication, but for x. And small replications for epsilon for your
exact.
Okay.
This is what. Yes.
Maybe one more quick question.
Yes.
Yes.
Attention. Si la question est dure, il est mort.
Good morning, Mr. Yass. I just wanted to ask. So you compute your several indices on the outputs of a meta model. And so you mentioned that you can have confidence intervals on these Sobol indices.
I don't understand. You excuse me.
You your Sobol indices in your case, you compute them. If you can get maybe a bit more to the previous slides. No.
You want to see the formula?
Yes, please. Yes, this one. So the Y you have here, you use for your computation. That's from what you take. You take it from your meta models. You use cricking over your function G, and that's what you use to compute your simple indices.
Excuse me. I'm sorry.
Yeah, sure. Instead of the real, since it doesn't have the real value, so use your I. Just that you make simple, you compute simple indices out of. That's because you didn't hear me well. Should I speak?
I compute the simple indices on the empirical mean.
Exactly. No, I thought that was from after kriging.
After kriging?
Yes.
But I use the kriging, the Gaussian process, modelize the empirical mean.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
I apply Sobol indices on this.
And you mentioned that you can have confidence intervals since you use something that has already some error. There's an error on the outputs that you're using to compute the Sobol indices. And so you mentioned some confidence intervals.
Ah, yes, here we don't use the confidence intervals.
Okay, and is that something that would that could give you some relevant information to compute them?
Exactly, yes, it will be important to implement and to introduce the confidence intervals, but we didn't do it.
Okay, and is it these confidence intervals, are they those introduced by Alexandre Janon?
No. The confidence intervals I talk about has been proposed by this paper of Loïc Le Gracier. In fact, we have to control two errors when we estimate Sobol indices by the Gaussian process. The error due to the Gaussian process, approximations, and the error due to the Monte Carlo sample. And this method is very efficient because as a result, we can have the estimates and the total the overall variance and the variance coming from the Gaussian process and the variance coming from the Monte Carlo.
Thank you.
I don't know if I answered to the right question,
no,
but I answered
to
the
exactly
question.
Congratulations.